Now to talk about this and what can be done is the founder of Suma Home Care, Mariama Suma-Keita, and also assistant professor of economics at John Jay College of Criminal Justice, Michelle Holder. And Michelle, I know you just wrote a whole paper on this. So thank you both for being here. Mariama, let me just begin with you. You have 150 employees, and you were denied one loan, as I understand it. You got another PPP loan, but you don't even think it can sustain you guys.
Yes, great. Yes, I am a nurse by profession, and I am the owner of Suma Home Care. As a nurse, an owner with 150 employees, quality of care is priority to me. To make my employees safe, at this point, I am paying for premium rate for PPE. I am also paying hazard pay, which is very restraining to me at this point.
Michelle, you've been working on this for some time. I'm curious. It's a problem that Congress, lawmakers have been aware of for a number of weeks now, and there's been talk in the next phase of correcting some of these issues so that small businesses, including those owned by African Americans, find it easier to get funding. Based on what you're seeing, are these issues getting corrected?
Based on what I'm seeing, no, they're not. And I did want to point out that I think what's been missing in the narrative about job losses in America is that small businesses are a real engine of employment in the U.S., and particularly among minority-owned and business-owned firms. Minority-owned firms, particularly black-owned firms, tend to employ black workers, and there are over a million black workers currently, you know, well, not currently, but prior to the pandemic, who were working in black-owned businesses. So it's a real significant engine, and the Paycheck Protection Program really has to be more nimble to address these smaller businesses.
One of the big concerns, and what the data has shown, is that it's, you know, without a lot of that money going to CDFIs and to some of these directly into these communities, et cetera, the lending process isn't just, essentially. And so I just wonder what the long-term implication of this you think is going to be for America. If those jobs don't come back, if those minority-owned small businesses that have been lost don't come back, how long is the tail of that for America, and what does it mean more broadly for our economy?
Well, the tail would be pretty long. So as you all were pointing out earlier, you know, we don't really know when this will be over, right? And so the, you know, unemployment and joblessness, those are lagging indicators. So even once we get the epidemic sort of as under control as possible, joblessness is going to not just bounce right back. So unfortunately, I think particularly for minority-owned businesses who tend to have those types of businesses that provide personal service, barbershops, cleaners, salons, you know, shoe repair places, and they tend to be located in urban areas, this is really devastating because it's going to take quite a while for those businesses to bounce back.
Mariama, can you turn it around? I mean, if you get the help you need now, are you able to turn it around? There's a lot of concern that some of these jobs will not come back. Some of these small business owners like yourself won't be able to survive this. And I'm curious what you need to bridge that, and are you confident you'll get it?
For Suma Home Care, what I think we need to bridge this right now is for total forgiveness of the PPE loan, because with 150 employees, it's costing us a lot to buy the PPE to keep these employees safe at work. It's costing us a lot also giving them hazard pay. Also, the forgiveness will be great. We don't have fancy lawyers or a bunch of accountants to help us navigate through this critical process.
I think that's such a good point because you're right. Like, you know, businesses that can pay those accountants to figure this all out, it's a hard process to navigate. You know, they have a much easier road here. I know you got one loan. That's good. Hopefully the terms will change so that it is forgivable. But I understand you were turned down from TD Bank for one of your PPP loan applications. We reached out to the bank, our producers. They said they're more than happy to review your application again. So we just want you to know that in case that's something that you're looking to do, Mariama.
Oh, that's very great. But one thing I have to say, I want to say thank you to Natalie Molino-Nino, who actually, when I was denied from TD Bank, connected me with Live Oak Bank, who was
that's
able
great.
To give me the loan at the second attempt. So TD Bank is the bank that I really bank with. So I don't think second time around is great, but I think I needed it the beginning of everything. It's great that they could look at it. It was critical for me getting my employees the equipment that they need, giving them hazard pay, getting them to work, because all of these employees are from low socioeconomic communities, which is very important to me.
Well, listen, we're rooting for you. We're rooting for the business. And Michelle Holder, thanks so much for the work you do as well. Mariama Suma-Keita, too.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.